to reach the people that no one else is reaching. We're always going to be that weird, loud church that welcomes in people that others may feel like shouldn't be welcome. But I'm going to tell you, if you're hungover or you're barely hanging on at all, we got a place for you at Grace Family Church. That's what we believe.
See, when Jesus surrendered his life and gave his life to us because he loves you and he loves me, that's why he surrendered his life. No matter what you may believe or not believe about God, God is for you, not against you. You need to believe that about him.
We got to continue to keep reaching because we know this, God can redeem anyone.
Amen. Now, that always gets me excited. As Pastor said, we've been here about 7 years, and that's what I love about our church, just the way it reaches out and gets that message out to everyone in Tampa. So it's definitely exciting. It's exciting for me to be here today, too, and I don't take this lightly. I'm usually at the 9:30 service, so this has been great to get to see a lot of people that I don't usually see, get to speak to our campuses, our other campuses out there where I'm not usually involved. So it's awesome. Appreciate it. Shout out to all those guys. Also want to say hi tonight to my Wednesday Bible study group. A lot of those guys are watching online. So definitely appreciate them and welcome them. Also, I'd like to just give a shout out to our praise team. How about these guys? You see them here, but they do this all weekend. They did it earlier. They're going to do it tomorrow morning, early tomorrow, 11:30, the same way. They're going to bring the same energy all weekend. They're really, really awesome. Pastor Craig mentioned Wednesday night Bible study, and last Wednesday we actually studied Psalm 117, which is two verses about praising the Lord, and we found out that there are seven Hebrew words for praise. And one of them, the first, the base word is halal, which means to give praise, to give shouts to God. But I found out that tehillah, T-E-H-I-L-L-A-H, means to sing praises. And that's actually what our praise team does, to sing those shouts of praise. The definition of that, praise is done in worship, in song, and music. So just want to give thanks to our praise team for giving us some great tehillah this weekend. So thank you. Well, come bring greetings from the entire Dungy family, my beautiful wife Lauren, all of our kids. It's an exciting weekend for us, the weekend after Easter. It's kind of a tradition. Pastor Craig asked me to give the message, and my kids, first of all, are very, very excited because they know that the speaker gets free gift cards to the coffee shop. So me speaking means Frappuccinos and Krispy Kreme for the Dungy family. And that's my daughter Jade getting started there. She's at the Vintage at the shop down in South Tampa, and she's getting started on her Frappuccinos. So they're fired up. My wife Lauren is kind of excited for a different reason, because now she's got to get going a little earlier before the service and get 8 kids all dressed and ready and get them here on time. So I don't know if it's excitement for her or if it's adrenaline is definitely flowing, though. And then I'm excited. I'm excited because after fall and winter, where I'm gone quite a bit and I'm gone on Sundays doing the show for NBC, I finally can be here and feel like I'm giving something back to my church. And it's exciting to be up here and an honor to speak to you. It's exciting also to look back and see the way the Lord moved on Easter weekend. And Pastor gave you some of the statistics, but 2 weeks ago, Pastor Matt challenged all of us. Remember that? He said, break out of our normal conversations, break out of our normal groups, and reach out and invite some people to come to church. Invite people that needed to hear about Jesus. And you guys did that. You did that because we had last weekend over 22,000 people come, and we had over 2,300 people watching online. So almost 25,000 people over the weekend hearing the message. And that is awesome. Yeah, that deserves a shout. And they heard Pastor Craig and Pastor Matt talk about a second chance, about redemption, and 531 people filled out cards that said they received that second chance and became new Christians. And that deserves another shout. That's awesome. It's exciting. So I kind of want to talk to those 531 people today and talk about, okay, what's next? You accepted Christ. Okay, you're a Christian. You are going to heaven. Nothing in this universe can stop you from going to heaven, and that's a reason to celebrate. But what's the next step? What do we do now? And we are celebrating, okay? We're celebrating in the Dungy household because one of those 531 was actually our son, Jalen. And you see him up there. That's him with the red cape on. And if you have kids that were in the zone, what they did, every child who accepted Christ last week, they gave him a Superman cape. Yeah, okay? So he's got the cape on. We're excited and fired up in our household. But now we talk to Jalen, okay, what's the next step? Okay, where do you go from here? You're going to heaven. What do we do now? And in the midst of all that celebrating and happiness and joy, I hate to be a buzz killer, but when I talk to the new Christians, talk to the people that accepted Christ last week, I have to be totally honest. We've got to tell them the whole story, okay? The whole story is there's good news and bad news, okay? The good news is, hey, you're going to heaven. Amen. The bad news is you can't go right now, okay? God's got plans for you. You have to live and you have to get along with people here on earth until God calls you. And we don't know when that's going to be. It'd be nice, it'd be awesome if God just swooped us up as soon as we made the decision. Hey, I accept Christ, I accept Jesus, I know I need a Savior. Boom, you're gone, right to heaven. That would be perfect. Okay, we'd be right there, we'd be in His presence, we'd start celebrating eternity right now, immediately. But that's not the way it works, okay? And the reason it doesn't work that way, it wouldn't do much good to the people who are still on earth who still need to hear about Jesus, right? Think about that. What if the 12 apostles, as soon as they really understood what Jesus did when He rose from the dead on Easter morning, as soon as they figured that out, what if they went straight to heaven? There would have been no sharing of the word, no spreading of the word. It wouldn't have been a day of Pentecost. We would have missed Peter's sermon where 3,000 people got saved in one day. We wouldn't have the book of Matthew. We wouldn't have the book of John that we could read and give us instruction. What if Paul, what if he'd have just gotten swooped up as soon as he saw that light on the road to Damascus? Who would have taken the message to the Gentile world? Who would have written so many of the books in the New Testament that we enjoy and we get fruit from today? No, God had some work for those men to do before He took them to heaven. And guess what? He's got work for each one of us as well. In Acts chapter 1, verse 8, after Jesus rose from the dead on that first Easter, He spoke to His disciples, and He actually gave us our job description. He told us what work that He had for us. He said this to them, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be My witnesses, telling people about Me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." So that's what Jesus wants us to do. That's the job He has for all Christians, and that's to tell people. We are supposed to share the good news about Him to everybody we come in contact with. Well, you might be saying, well, you know, that's great, but I'm not a Peter, I'm not a Paul. I can't preach to 3,000 people. I'm not going to write a book of the Bible. And maybe you won't, but just maybe you'll be an Ananias. Okay, who's Ananias? Well, don't feel bad if you don't know who he is or don't know that much about him. He's only mentioned one time in the entire Bible, but it was one of the most important moments in the New Testament. Okay, in Acts chapter 9, Ananias delivered a message from God to Paul. He placed his hands on him, and he said, "Paul, you're going to suffer for the kingdom of God." And that's all we know about Ananias. But that one act of obedience, doing what God told him to do, changed the whole course of church history. You see, Ananias opened Paul's eyes to some things and started him on his way to becoming the greatest missionary in the history of the church. That's why God isn't taking you. That's why God isn't taking me to heaven right now. We don't know when he's going to take us, but until he does, he's got something planned for you. He's got something planned for me. He's got someone for you to tell about Jesus. And just like Ananias, you might not know just how significant it's going to be to tell that one person. So you're going to need to walk out this Christian life, these new Christians that accepted Jesus last week. You're going to need to walk out that life here on earth. You're going to need to be obedient to whatever call God gives you. And I've got a little more news from you. That's not going to be easy. Okay? It wasn't easy for Ananias. See, God called him. God said, go speak to Paul. You know what Paul was doing when God told Ananias to talk to him? He was putting Christians in prison. He was having Christians killed. And God said, that's who I want you to talk to. So our jobs won't always be easy. In fact, if you accepted Christ because you thought it would make everything in life just smooth and great and easy, you're going to be disappointed, right? We often lead people to think that. Oh, come to Jesus and we need to do that. But that doesn't mean everything's going to be smooth. Jesus let us know that. He let his disciples know that in John chapter 16. They were having this deep conversation about life and what was going on and what was going to happen. And in verse 33, Jesus said this to them. He said, I have told you all this so you may have peace in me. Here on earth, you will have what? Many trials and sorrows. But take heart because I have overcome the world. Oh, that'll preach, huh? Okay. Now, what did he mean by that? What was Jesus saying? Well, he was just confirming what we're just saying right here. There's good news and there's bad news, okay? The good news, he assured them that nothing should shake their faith at all. Their destiny was secure. They had accepted him. They knew who he was. Satan could no longer prevent them from going to heaven. So that's great news. All the accusations he was going to make against them wouldn't amount to anything. And Jesus told the disciples, that should give you peace. That is something to celebrate. But the bad news is, that doesn't mean Satan is finished trying. Okay? Satan doesn't want you to be able to do your job, which is to tell others about Christ. Now, he can't block you from going to heaven. He knows that. So there's nothing he'd like better to do than detour you here on earth. Make your journey as miserable as possible, destroy your testimony so that other people won't follow you to heaven. So the reality for those new Christians is this. This new life, this journey you're on, hey, you're still going to have issues. You're still going to have health problems. You're still going to have relationship problems. You still may have problems at work. And on top of that, now you're going to have Satan attacking you because you're on the other side now. You're not on his team anymore. He's going to try to derail you. You're going to have people who used to be very close to you that all of a sudden think you're weird. Okay? You're going to have people that don't like you because of your beliefs, because you stand up for the Lord. So in some ways, life is going to be a little bit tougher. But what did Jesus say? He said, take heart. Be joyful. Don't worry about any of that. Why? Because he said, I have overcome all of that. Well, how do we take advantage of that? If Jesus has overcome Satan, he's overcome the world, how do we take advantage of it? Well, I've got a little more bad news for you. Okay? It doesn't just happen. It doesn't come naturally. We have to grow. We have to mature. And that takes work on our part. Okay? But as Jesus said, we can take heart. And there's one thing we can take heart in is that every single Christian on earth has gone through that same exact process of growing. Because when we accept Christ, we all start at the same point. We all have to start from scratch. If you were here last week, you heard Pastor Craig talk about it. He talked about 1 Corinthians 5:17. And he told us that we can all have a second chance and a fresh start with Jesus because of what this verse says. The Apostle Paul said, this means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone. Whatever was gone before was not there anymore. A new life has just begun. So that is awesome. That's a beautiful verse. We've got a fresh start. We accept Christ. Amen. But it also means that we're starting from square one. Some of us may have heard more about Jesus growing up than others. Some of us may have had a better home environment than others. Some of us may have spent more time in church than others. But at the moment we say, Jesus, I want you to come into my heart, come into my life, direct me, I accept you, we begin a new spiritual life and we're an infant, brand new, a baby. And so that spiritual nature has to grow. And how does that happen? How does that spiritual nature grow? Well, it happens just like it does with any baby. How many of you are parents out there? Got any parents in the crowd? All right. Well, if you've been around newborn babies at all, you know how things work, right? Every 2 or 3 hours, they cry. And when they cry at that age, it's one of two things. They need to be changed or they need to be fed. And if you got a great baby, a really, really perfect baby, it might go 4 hours. Okay? But that's about it. Then they get hungry. They need food to keep growing, so they cry. And if you don't get that food to them quick enough, they scream. Okay? I've been through it. We have 10, so I know the cycle. I know how that works. But that's because babies know they have to eat to survive. And so when they need that, they cry. And that desire stays with us our whole life. Okay? As we grow into adults, okay, we don't necessarily need to eat every 2 or 3 hours, but we need to eat regularly. Most of us eat pretty often, right? Even those of us who are trying to lose weight, we still don't go a long time without eating. Well, you know what? The same principle applies to our spiritual lives. If we want to grow spiritually, we have to eat. We have to feed that spiritual side just as regularly. We can't come to church once a week, even though we're going to hear great praise and worship, even though we're going to hear a great message from our pastors. We can't just come once a week on Sunday and feel like it's going to hold us over until the next Sunday. Can't do that physically, we can't do that spiritually. Imagine if you had that little baby and you fed him once a week. Okay, how long is that baby going to survive? And if someone saw you doing that, feeding that baby once a week, they wouldn't say, wow, what a great parent. They'd be calling Child Protection Services, right? So what's wrong with that person trying to feed a baby one time a week? But that's what many of us are doing spiritually. We might think we're doing okay because we feel okay physically, but spiritually we're looking just like that little baby who's only eating once a week. And God has put that same type of mechanism inside us that the baby has. We will naturally feel the need to hear more from the Lord. We'll need to feed our spiritual side. 1 Peter chapter 2, Peter wrote this, and he was talking about this same process. He said, like newborn babies, you must crave pure spiritual milk so that you will grow into a full experience of salvation. Not that you'll need that to get salvation, you've already got it. But he's saying if you want the full experience, you want to grow and mature, okay, you've got to crave that pure spiritual milk. He says, cry out for this nourishment. So like babies, we as Christians, we have to grow. But the difference is God gives us a choice. Peter said, crave the spiritual milk. He tells us to cry out for it, but God doesn't make us cry out for it. Okay? He allows us to do that. We have to decide. And God is not going to have parents who just sit there and feed us. Okay? We've got to decide we want it, and we have to do it ourselves. We've got to feed ourselves. But the good news on that side of the coin is if we decide we want to do that and we decide we want spiritual food, there are plenty of outlets to get it. Okay? There was a time when Bibles were rare. People didn't have Bibles. Okay? I've got Bibles all over my house now. Okay? We've got translations in modern English that we can read and it's good for us, it's easy. We've got something else too that Christians a generation ago didn't have. I know we curse these things sometimes, but we have electronics, okay? And there's some fantastic stuff on here to grow if we'll use it. We've got the Bible on our phone, right? I can push a button and someone can talk to me and read the Bible to me, okay? We've got the Bible on videos. We've got podcasts. We've got apps. My wife has Sirius XM. She can go be traveling down the street and turn her radio on and get Tony Evans or Joel Osteen or anybody that she wants to hear. Okay? It's awesome. We have access to so much good spiritual food in addition to what we're going to get here on Sundays or on Saturday night. But we've got to access it. We've got to realize how important it is. We've got to have that desire to grow. I think back to when I was a lot younger, when I was still playing football. I had this goal. I wanted to play in the National Football League, and I went after it. I fought hard to get there, and I finally made it. I was on the Pittsburgh Steelers, and it was pretty unbelievable. Here I was, young guy, 21 years old, and I was on this team with Hall of Fame players, Hall of Fame coach. It was fantastic. Never mind the fact that I wasn't a very good player. So I was on the team, even though I didn't get to play much, I was pretty excited. It didn't matter that I wasn't doing too much. I was on the Pittsburgh Steelers. I remember one time, my rookie year, I did get in a game, and I made a tackle. And the PA announcer said, "Tackle by Tony Dungy." And Dwight White looked at me in the huddle. He said, "Are you still on the team?" It was rare for me to get in the game. A lot of the guys didn't even know who I was on the team. But you know what? For me, it was exciting. I was a Steeler. I'd walk around town. People would say, "Do you play for the Steelers?" And I'd say, "Yeah, yeah." "Well, I don't play, but I'm on the team." I was just having fun. But going into my second year, my attitude changed a little bit. I went from just being happy to being a member of the team to really wanting to play more. I need to get out there. I want to help the team win, but I want to do something. I want to get involved, get into action myself. I want to get on the field. So I went in and I talked to my coach. I said, "What do I need to do if I want to play more?" And he said, "Well, you need to learn your assignments, number one, so I can trust you. If I put you in, you'll know what to do. You won't make a mistake." And then he said I had to get stronger. Okay, I wasn't as physically strong as these guys, and if I was going to hold up against the other team, I needed to make sure I was in a little bit better shape. And he said the best way I could do that was to get around some of the veteran players and follow them, see how they prepared and do what they did. So I took him up on that. I did that. I worked out the whole off season. I lifted weights, I ran, I trained so I'd be as strong as possible when I came back to training camp that second year. And I read my playbook over and over and over again. I wanted to make sure I knew exactly what to do on every single play. Well, I did all that, and you know what? I did get to play a lot more my second year. And it was amazing. It was so different. I thought I was having fun that first year, but man, when I was in the games, man, it was something. And I can remember coming back in the locker room after a big win and just feeling like, man, I did something. I helped us win the game today. It was so gratifying. But it also let me know why I didn't get to play much the year before, because I didn't know exactly what I was doing. I wasn't quite strong enough. I could have made some mistakes that hurt the team, and that's why the coach didn't put me in, because I wasn't quite ready. Well, as I look back on my football career, I think it's a great analogy to Christian life. Oftentimes, when we come to Christ, it is exciting. We're fired up to be on the team. As Pastor Craig said, we're a new creation. New things are happening for us. So we're like I was that first year, just excited to be on the team. But we heard Peter say, we can't stay baby Christians or rookie Christians forever. Okay? Can't just be happy that we're going to heaven. If we want to do the job that God has for us, if we want to get in the game and make a difference for God's kingdom, we've got to mature in our faith. And that's not just something we should want to do. That's what God expects us to do. That's what He requires. So the question then becomes, if that's what God wants us to do, how do we do that? How do we mature? What's the best way to grow as a Christian and prepare myself for this work that God has for us? Well, to answer that, I'd give you the same advice my coach gave me when I asked him how to be a better player. I wanted to improve, and he said there are three things you need to do. First thing he told me was get in the playbook. And the playbook for us is the Bible. Okay? It's great to come here to Grace on the weekends and hear a message. I love it, and we get some great messages. It makes me think when I hear Pastor Craig, when I hear Pastor Matt, Pastor Ralph a couple of weeks ago. It makes me think about how I want to live, what I want to do with my life, but we can't just exist off those messages alone. We need to dig into these Bibles for ourselves and let God speak to us. We need to read and let the Holy Spirit convict us by what we're reading, because this is God's Word. This is Him talking to us. So what exactly would you suggest to read, you might ask me? Well, that depends on where you are. There's a lot of things in the Bible. If you're a new Christian, those people who just accepted Christ last week, I'd recommend the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They give us a real look at Jesus and how He lived and His life and His mission. You want to go deeper than that. You've been a Christian for a while. Hey, Ephesians, Galatians, those letters from Paul, Corinthians, Thessalonians, where he's telling new believers, he's telling older believers what God expects, how we need to live. The Old Testament is awesome. It's books full of history and application for us, relevant stories. But the key thing is to figure out a way to read every single day. It doesn't matter if you just accepted Christ last week or if you've been a Christian for 40 years. Reading the Bible is critical, because God will speak to you when you read His Word. No question about it. Now, the great thing, as I said, we've got going. You can get on your phone. You can get an app that'll give you a plan, and it'll ring a buzzer for you and remind you you need to read today. Plans for everybody, men, plans for women, plans for groups. You can read about a specific topic. You can even have order a plan on this phone that'll take you through the Bible all the way in 1 year. But whether you read on your own, whether you read in a plan, whether you read with a group, the important thing is to make sure you're reading God's Word regularly. That's how you're going to know what to do in life, and read that playbook. Second thing my coach told me was to get around the right teammates. He said, make sure I got to know the veteran guys who were serious about their roles on the team, to follow them and hang with them, learn from them. Well, on a football team, that's called teamwork. Okay? Spiritually, it's called fellowship, and it's beneficial to any Christian, but fellowship is particularly important to someone who wants to grow. Okay? Being around more mature believers and learning from them is really, really essential for young Christians. But that process goes both ways. Okay? Yes, the younger person grows, but the more mature person grows as well, because fellowship works both ways. Staying around other believers helps keep us sharp, helps keep us focused on the things that really, really matter, that are really important in life, things that can sometimes get lost in the shuffle of everyday life. Then the third thing my coach told me to do was get in shape, work out, get stronger. He told me developing strength would be important as the games got tougher and more competitive. So how do you do that spiritually? How do you work out? How do you get stronger? Well, you do that by serving, by getting involved in projects to not only serve the Lord, but to help other people. There's a story in Matthew chapter 20. Jesus' disciples were trying to figure out how they were going to become the stars of His team. They wanted to be the quarterback or the captain. And they asked Jesus what they needed to do. And what Jesus told them, I think, caught them off guard a little bit. In verse 26, He told them the way to get to the top of His team was by serving. He said, but among you, it will be different. Whoever wants to be a leader on my team, or whoever wants to be a leader among you, must be the servant. Well, I know that had to catch them by surprise. Jesus said, hey, it's not going to be the one who has the most credentials. It's not going to be the one who's got the biggest contract. It's not going to be the one who's the most talented. He said the star of his team was going to be the person with the biggest heart, the one who served his team and served his community. That's who would get to the top. So to summarize that, to get off the bench and get in the game spiritually, we need to read our Bibles, we need to fellowship with other Christians, and we need to serve our community. And I can tell you that one of the best ways I know to do all that is to join a small group. Okay? Here at Grace, there are over 400 small groups operating right now. Okay? There are groups for men, we've got groups for women, we've got groups for couples, groups that meet on every campus. Some meet at the church, some meet at home, some meet at other places. Almost anything you're interested in, you can find somebody who shares that interest and join a group with them. And I want to give you a great example. My wife Lauren is in a group called the Iron Sharpeners. Okay? Iron Sharpeners is a women's running group. They work out together because they like it. Okay? I don't run. I don't like to run. Okay? That would not be the group that I would want to join, but they love it. But it's more than just running and working out and getting in shape. Yes, it's physical fitness, but they do Bible study. Okay? They fellowship together. They pray for each other. They pray with each other, and they serve. Okay? They go out, they visit ministries all over the city, they volunteer to help out, and they also do what Jesus told us to do in Acts chapter 1:8 when they run. They witness. Okay? You know how they do that? This way. By wearing these crazy uniforms, okay, that say Iron Sharpeners on them. They wear these crazy different colored socks, and when they run, people say, what's an iron sharpener? And then they can tell them about Proverbs and iron sharpening iron. They can tell them about Jesus, and they have a great time. They witness. Now, when I say small group, that's probably not what you're thinking of, okay? You might be thinking of someone who's sitting around a table studying. Okay, they do some of that, but they do a lot more. They're effective, they're awesome, and this is what we're talking about. And there are hundreds of groups like that here at Grace. All you have to do is find one. Now, if you're tech savvy and you can use these, you could go online, gfconline.com, and you could walk yourself through the search process and look at the different groups, and you'd probably find one. But we're going to make it a little easier today for you to do that. We're going to get ready to dismiss, but before we dismiss, I want to introduce you to some people who can help you find your niche here at Grace. So we're going to call right now our prayer team up front. We're going to call our blue shirt team up front. And on all our campuses, we're going to do the same thing. We're going to have our campus pastors come forward and lead this part of the service.